Children may be dismissed, I believe. Little technology going on, huh? It's almost like we're in a spiritual battle or something. I don't know. Right? Technology is great when it works. Well, we'll get there, I think. Today we're going to be wrapping up our series on the armor of God, a wonderful section of scripture that is enormous, enormous help to us. So go ahead, turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6, and we're going to be in verses 10 through 20. Ephesians chapter 6, 10 through 20. Open your Bible. If you don't have one, there should be a Pew Bible right in front of you. It's on page 1245 of the Pew Bible. Let's read this passage together again. Finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Spiritual warfare. We don't like to talk about that much. Some people have a hard time being honest and would rather avoid that subject altogether. For some, it makes them feel vulnerable. Or maybe that they're not a good Christian. You know, a good Christian, if they admit that they're experiencing attacks. Bad things happen to you because you've done something wrong, right? God is punishing you. That's what Job's friends thought. But Paul, perhaps the greatest Christian that we know, makes it clear that that's not the case. He says that all Christians have a struggle. All Christians have a struggle. We all wrestle against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And that word he uses, wrestle, pele, means struggle. It's a fight. It's a conflict. It's a wrestling match. It's hand-to-hand combat. That's the word that he uses there to illustrate how close contact we come with these forces of darkness. So even though we're believers, Satan doesn't give up. He sends out his demonic forces against us. He uses all the subtlety and the strategy that he has perfected over many, many years, experience attacking other Christians. He gets all up in our business, right? All up in it. And he uses it all against us to trip us up, to pull us down, to get us to dishonor Christ, to try to destroy us. A real battle is underway. Throughout Scripture, we see that Christians are engaged in a spiritual battle. We're often warned against underestimating the enemy that we have. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober-minded. Be sober-minded. Think clearly. Think about this. Don't Don't just ignore it. Be sober-minded. Be watchful. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. But even worse than underestimating our enemy would be to not even realize that we're experiencing a war, that there is a war going on around us, that we're in the middle of it. But that's where Paul ends his letter to the early Christians in Ephesus. After telling all the ways for them to live out their newfound faith, all the practical things. You're in Christ, and that's great. And he starts off with the first part of Ephesians, telling us about our position before Christ. It's wonderful. And then he tells us how to live out that faith now. But in the end, he warns them, it's not going to be easy. Attacks will come. You need to be prepared for what lays ahead as a Christian. I started out this series by sharing the message General Eisenhower gave to the men before the invasion of Normandy on D-Day. His now famous letter to the soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Forces. And he let them know that they were about to embark upon the Great Crusade to bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world. After instilling confidence, he didn't suggest that the task was going to be easy, that the enemy would be defeated quickly. Instead, he wrote these words, "Your task will not be an easy one. Your enemy is well-trained. He's well-equipped, and he's battle-hardened. This is not his first fight. He will fight savagely." See, he wanted them to understand the reality of the battle that they faced. Paul does the same thing here in Ephesians chapter 6. But he also lets them know that we were not defenseless. They and we have been given what we need to stand in the evil day. He uses the Roman soldier's armor to describe what he calls the whole armor of God that we need to put on. And so we're going to go through, briefly review these pieces of armor that we've covered over the last several weeks. Before we can put on the armor of God, we must first take off the armor of self. The armor of self. Too often, we don't really trust in God. Sure, we say that we trust Jesus for salvation, but then we spend the rest of our lives trying to earn it through our good deeds or by living a good life. We achieve some success, and then we can become pretty enamored with ourselves, right? I'm doing pretty good. We do well in school. We get good grades. We do well in athletics. We become the captain of the football team, you know. We get a good job. Start making good money. Got the wife, we got the kids, we got the house, we got the boat. You know, life's going well. We begin to trust ourselves, put confidence in ourselves, not really God. We can get to this point where we say, you know what? I'm doing good. He can go help somebody else who really needs help. Because we're doing just fine here. Doing okay. We learned the folly of that attitude recently with the church of Laodicea. Remember when we went through the seven churches? The lukewarm church, that they had grown so confident in themselves and their success, they said that they were in need of nothing. We don't need anybody's help. In reality, they couldn't even supply their own basic need, their most basic need. We need to put our confidence in the Lord. Paul said in Philippians 3:3 that those who worship God glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in human effort. We must not trust in ourselves or our abilities. You cannot stand against the schemes of the devil in your own power. You can't. Paul says to be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Whose might? His. The Lord's. I mean, why would you trust your own? I mean, seriously, I mean, honestly, take a look at your life. Take a look at your life. Trusting in yourself. How's that worked out for you? Those times where you trusted your own power, how did it work out? Do you really think that you're any match for the schemes of the devil? We first need to remove the armor of self before we can put on the armor of God. And Paul draws from the image of the Roman soldier to illustrate how we are to defend ourselves with God's armor. So let's review those pieces of armor here. The belt of truth. The belt of truth. The belt of truth. Paul starts out this list of armor telling us to take up the belt of truth. Take up. The word he uses literally means to pick it up. The image of a soldier standing in the midst of all of his armor. It's laying there. He has to take possession of what's been given to him. He has to put it on. He has to take it up and put it on. Armor does no good until it's put on. So that's the first thing that we need to remember, that we must put on our armor. We must put it on. And so what's this piece of armor, this belt of truth? Paul used the imagery of the soldier's belt there, and we went through it quite a bit when we covered the belt. It was wide and supportive, like a weightlifter's belt. Remember the breech clout we talked about, the breech clout that it had in the front. A soldier would put it on when he was preparing for battle. They would pull up their robe, right? They'd pull up their robe and gather it together, and then they'd put on that belt, and that belt would kind of gather everything and hold everything together so that they could run. They wouldn't get tripped up by that long flowing robes that they would wear. The belt was also there to help give a place to secure the other pieces of armor. Had other places that you could attach those other pieces of armor to. The belt held everything together. They girded their loins. They prepared themselves. They put on that belt. They girded their loins. They were ready to fight. They were on duty when they put on that belt. We're to gird ourselves too, but our girding is spiritual and it's mental. 1 Peter 1:13, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind. Told to prepare for action. By putting on our belt is not leather, it is the belt of truth. Just as the belt was the foundation of the soldier's armor, the truth is the foundation of the Christian's life. Amen. If we're to stand in the evil day, we must stand in the truth. We must stand in the truth. The truth of God's word. John 17:17, Jesus said, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. We must know God's word so that we know the truth, so that we're not tossed to and fro. It says every wind of doctrine, it says in Ephesians 4:14, influence when people try to trick us with lies that are so clever that they sound like truth, right? The world is pretty good about doing that. There is only one truth, and it's found in God's written word. We must not accept any substitutes, and then we must commit to live in submission to that truth. It's not enough to just know God's word. You have to submit yourself to it. It's not enough to say, yep, that's what God's word says. I believe that's true. Now, I'm not going to let it affect my life and the way I live. No, that's not what this means. You put on that belt, you know the truth. And then you put on that belt by gathering up those loose areas of your life, those things that can trip you up. Remember the breech clout? Remember that breech clout we talked about that hung down the front? It protected the soldier's ability to reproduce. Individual believers in the church must stand on, they must guard, must wear the truth so that we're credible witnesses to the lost. It's the only way we can fulfill the Great Commission, stand on the truth. The truth is what holds everything together. It's the very foundation of the Christian life. So we must We must put on the belt. We must buckle up. Next, we looked at the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of a Roman soldier was a very heavy leather or metal that was form-fitted around the body and often covered the front and the back. Its purpose was to protect the vital organs of the torso, the hearts, the lungs, the spleen, the kidneys, all of the guts. Jewish thinking believed that the heart represented the will and the mind of a person. The bowels, the internal organs, the guts were the seat of emotion and feelings. We still have a similar way of thinking. What you think in your heart of hearts, right? Sometimes when you have a serious talk with somebody, you speak from the heart. Sometimes we have a gut reaction to something, right? Or if we're nervous, we have butterflies in our stomach. If we're betrayed, it feels like we've been punched in the gut. The breastplate, Paul describes, protects the two areas of life that Satan most frequently attacks the Christian. It's the mind and the emotions. There are two forms of righteousness that are involved here with the breastplate. Neither of them is self-righteousness. First is imputed righteousness. We talked about that. That's received from Christ. It's imputed. It's ascribed. It's assigned. It's credited to our account. Christ's righteousness is credited to us when we come to faith in Him. Philippians 3:9, and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. When we come to faith in Christ, we're clothed in His righteousness, right? We're clothed. We put it on. We're seen as holy and clean before God the Father. And then that should cause us to live out practical righteousness. That's the other righteousness that's involved. That's the power of progressive sanctification as we begin to live out our faith in obedience to God's word, to follow after Jesus. Both of those things shield us from attacks with our minds and our emotions. When the devil says that we're not good enough, we say, yes, you're right. I'm not. I'm not good enough. But Jesus is. But Jesus is. And I stand in His righteousness. I believe God's truth, not your lies. Protect our minds. Satan's attacks are deflected when we know where we stand before God. He loses the power over us when we live righteously. The breastplate is what protects the core of your being from spiritual attacks. When he speaks all kinds of lies into you, God's word informs our thoughts and feelings, not the world. It's a powerful defense against the attacks of the enemy. When we allow sin to dwell in our lives, we give Satan an opening which he can use to attack and to exploit us. All you got to do, just give him a crack, a little foothold, and he'll come right in. Holiness closes the door and helps protect us from those attacks. Breastplate of righteousness refers to the power of a holy life, one lived in Christ in accordance with God's word. Next we looked at the breastplate, or the shoes of peace. The shoes of peace. Having put on the shoes of peace, Paul next referred to the shoes that the Roman soldier wore. Caligae. Purpose-built shoes that provided critical support, comfortable, breathable, so that they could march for miles. Right? They had very thick spike soles that gave them great traction. Soldiers' shoes were critical to stand firm in the battle. These shoes are the gospel of peace. The good news that we who were once at enmity with God, once at enmity, we were against one another, but now we're at peace. We're at peace with Him through Jesus. Romans 5:1, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Having our feet shod with the gospel of peace means that we stand in absolute confidence that God loves us. He's forgiven us, that we're united with him and that he fights for us. He's on our side. We're on his side. We're united with him. We're no longer opposed. It's confidence that we're saved from a sinful past. We have a glorious future. When we possess the peace of God in our hearts, we're ready to stand against any enemy that would come against us. Having put on the readiness, it says, readiness given by the gospel of peace. We're vigilant. We're prepared for the battle that may come. And these shoes are not just to help us stand defensively. They also help us to advance into enemy territory. And the battleground will be rocky. It will be uneven. It will be unfair. There will be obstacles to climb over as we seek to spread the gospel, which is our mission as soldiers in God's army. You are saved by grace. Don't ever be moved from that. These first three pieces are ones that we are to put on, that we wear all the time. It's something that we put on and we walk around with these things on all the time. The next three we are to take up. They're to be picked up when the battle begins. The shield of faith says to take up the shield of faith. The Roman thorough shield that Paul was referring to here was about 3 foot by 4 foot. It was decent size. It was designed to cover the entire body of the Roman soldier. It was slightly curved, wrapped around them. It was made of wood. It had metal edges around it so that a sword that would strike it would bounce off and not dig into it. It's wrapped in leather, heavily oiled, usually olive oil. And they were used defensively and offensively. We talked about how the soldiers would get into a turtle formation, a testito, where they would interlock their shields, right? They would present almost this impenetrable barrier as they advanced. As they stood there and the enemy would lob things at them, they would present this impenetrable defense. And then they would move forward. They would not just stand there, they would then move forward. The Christian is to take up the shield of faith. Faith is a belief. It's a firm persuasion. It's conviction. It's assurance. Firm belief and trust in the Lord that saves and strengthens us. Faith is a necessary, it's a non-negotiable component to the Christian life. Hebrews 11:1, assurance of things hoped for and a conviction of things not seen. But it's not a blind faith either. We talked about that. Faith has three components: knowledge, assent, and trust. When we learn about things, we learn about God and his word. It's knowledge. And we give assent. We accept it as being true. And that leads us to trust. We act on it. Faith is not just saying that you believe in something. Your faith is demonstrated through your actions, taking action based upon that truth. God has given us his word. He's told us about himself. He's given us promises. Get to know your God. You or someone that you know has witnessed his promises kept. It's part of why he brings us together as a body, so that we can share those things with one another. He has proven himself trustworthy. He's proven himself trustworthy. You must act in that belief. You must trust him. This piece of armor must be taken up. It's actively held in your hand. You must use it. It's not passive. Some of the other pieces are a little bit more passive. This is one that you must actively use. It's in your hand. It's necessary to extinguish the flaming darts the enemy lobs our way. Fear and accusation, doubt and anxiety, right? Each of those are put out when we put our trust, our faith in God, what He says about us, what He's done for us, the promises to do for us in the future. Right? Amen. One of the other things, too, you think about the flaming darts. Why flaming darts? Why does the enemy lob flaming darts at us? Normally, flaming darts, they're not shot in the daytime. Normally, at night, and it's dark. Why? Psychological warfare. It's to scare us. Those flaming darts come our way, it instills fear into us. When we're in those dark times, that's when we're most vulnerable. It scares us. We need to lock shields with fellow soldiers, the testigo formation. Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. It's why we're together in a body. It's why we're told not to forsake the assembly. It's why we don't all just go out and live our faith by ourselves alone. We're to come together. It strengthens each of us. It offers protection to one another. When one is attacked, we can come to one another's defense. We form a stronger barrier against the devil. The shield protects the other armor too. The other pieces are there for when we slip up, when our faith fails. An arrow gets by. Because no smart soldier runs into battle with just his breastplate. The shield of faith is our unshakable belief and trust in God that leads to action in our daily lives, willing to follow wherever He leads. And then the helmet of salvation. The Roman soldier knew they needed to protect their heads. One of the clearest ways to take out an opponent is to take off his head, right? Take off their head, they can't fight anymore. The Roman soldier's helmet was a masterful piece of work. We talked a little bit about it. The cheek flaps and the browed eye ridges that would deflect the blade as the blade came along. It would deflect the blade. Nose guards and chin straps and a flared bottom that would protect the shoulders. It's topped with a crest that proudly proclaimed the army that they belonged to, right? Crucial army to protect against the wild swings of the broadsword. A Christian must protect their head too and what it houses, the mind. A Christian must protect their mind about what they believe, specifically about their salvation. The enemy would do nothing more than to infect our minds with wrong thinking about this critical part of our faith. Really, one of the things that he's done, he's invaded the church and he's given so much misinformation about this part of the Christian life. Salvation. We need to guard our minds against lies and falsehoods and misunderstandings. We must know what we know about our salvation. All its phases, we talked about that. Having a knowledge based upon Scripture that gives the promise for and assurance of salvation. A right understanding of what it is. What it is. Salvation. Salvation from what? From sin. Those things that we do that are against God's law. Saved from its consequences, from its control, from its very presence. Those that are in Christ are saved past, present, and future. Past, we all sin. We all sin. All have chosen fleshly desires. Romans 3:23, all have sinned. All fall short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, but the wages of sin is death. But Romans 5:8 says, God shows His love. And while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for every sin that you committed. Every sin that you committed, Christ died for. You are saved from consequences of sin. You are now justified before a holy judge. Present, salvation is an ongoing process. Every day as you grow in faith, you are being changed. Romans 12:2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. The Holy Spirit works within you to save you from sin's control over your present life, to say no to those things that you used to say yes to. That's our sanctification, continually being saved from sin's control. A future, that's an eternal salvation to come. Revelation 21:4 tells about a time when God will wipe away every tear. There will be no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain. This will be in heaven. Why? Revelation 21:27 says, nothing impure will ever enter into it. In heaven, there will be no death. There will be no sorrow. There will be no pain because sin is gone. Because sin is gone. One day, we will be saved from the very presence of sin. That's glorification. That's the glorious future that we look forward to. Complete confidence, the power that God has, is, and will save us from all sin, past, present, and future. When we have complete confidence and assurance of salvation, we can stand in the midst of any battle without fear. And the sword of the Spirit, once again, the image of a Roman soldier and the things that he would have on him. Paul here refers to the small dagger, the gladius sword that a soldier would have carried. This sword was not used in wild swinging attacks. This sword was a small one, a dagger-like sword. It was reserved for up-close, personal battles, face-to-face. It stood toe-to-toe with the enemy. The soldier would look for an opening, the right opportunity that he could stick this blade in. This weapon was used with skill, precision. This little dagger had to hit a specific spot. It had to look for the right opening, a chink in the armor. It was used defensively and offensively, just like the Spirit provided an enabled word of God. The sword is the word of God, but it's provided by and through the Holy Spirit. The word of God and the Holy Spirit always work together in tandem. The word of God we talked about is the word used here is not logos. It's not logos, the whole word of God, but rhema. Logos is the entirety of God's word. Rhema is a specific passage within it. Jesus was the perfect example of using rhema, using the sword of the Spirit when he was tempted in the wilderness, right? Satan tries to tempt Jesus with the allure of food and pride and power. And each time Jesus replied with the precise scripture that refuted Satan. Each time he replied with, it is written, it is written, it is written. When we're tempted to doubt who God is, to compromise the gospel, decide for ourselves what's right or wrong, our response must also always be, it is written. It is written. The Holy Spirit is the one that puts the word, the specific verse needed for the moment, in our hands. He's the one that brings it to mind. We must know God's word so that we have a full war chest of scriptures for the Spirit to draw from. Jesus defeated Satan's onslaught by quoting scripture. That's how we use it defensively. But we need to use it offensively too. We need to gain ground for the kingdom. There are people out there that need to hear the word of God. The Holy Spirit also leads us with the right word as we talk to them. The right word that will convict where it needs conviction, where conviction is needed. He will give us the words to speak. The words that will bring conversion, that will cleanse those that desperately need it. The sword of the Spirit defends, teaches, it convicts, it saves, it edifies, it glorifies. We must read, we must hear, we must study, we must believe, we must apply, we must share the word. And then prayer. Although it's not listed as a piece of the armor, prayer is the most important thing that we have been provided for the battle. Prayer is nothing more. It's simply talking with God. Talking with God. The soul of man calling out to the one who made him. Primary way for a believer to communicate and to fellowship with God. Armies of the world have struggled for generations to get what Christians have always had, the ability, instant ability to communicate with our commander. Instant ability to call in air support when it's needed. What an amazing privilege we have to have instant access to God. Talked about the four alls. We need to pray in the four alls at all times, all kinds of prayers, all perseverance. For all the saints. We're in a spiritual battle, so we need to respond with spirit-filled prayer. Prayer that is empowered by the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, 26 through 27, the Spirit helps in our weakness. When we do not know what we need, ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. The Spirit knows what we need. Even when we don't know what we need, he knows. And he intercedes. Our prayers must be watchful to those areas in our life vulnerable to attack. Areas that need to be honed, that need to be realigned. Those areas that need to be sharpened. It must be gospel-based. Gospel-empowered and gospel-motivated. Ephesians 2 tells us Christ is our peace and that he has broken down that middle ground, that middle wall of hostility that was between us. He was talking of the reconciliation of Jews and Gentiles and then both of them to God. His shed blood on the cross overcame enmity with us and God. Through Christ we have access to God in one spirit. We drop down to Ephesians 3:12, that amazing statement, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence. Boldness and outspoken frankness, no hesitation, no fear. It's the opposite of shy. Access, the ability, permission to approach, to enter, to speak with absolute boldness. It's the idea of an inferior subject approaching a king. Having special unrestricted access to the Oval Office, the President. We have access to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God, creator of the universe, gives us access to his very presence because of Christ, because of the gospel. It's an amazing privilege that we have. And then confidence, firm trust, certain about something. A hopeful confidence, an expectation of being heard. You can be bold. You can speak your mind because you have access. We have full confidence that God will hear and he will listen. You get all of that because and through the gospel. The gospel gives us access to approach the throne of God in prayer with a bold confidence that he hears our prayers. And then that should motivate us to want to share that same privilege that we have. That was Paul's prayer, that he would have boldness to boldly proclaim the gospel. Last, we need to understand your blessings. You need to get dressed. The reason for putting on the whole armor of God is because you need it. You need the armor. You need it to withstand the spiritual pressures that you're going to face. Here to let you know, you have much in Christ. It's true. Amen. We have an amazing position before God because of what Christ has done for us. But we have a determined enemy who seeks to destroy us. It's not going to be always easy. That's probably one of the worst things that any evangelist, any preacher can ever do to somebody when they lead them to Christ. You have difficulty in your life? Give it all to Jesus. He'll make it all wonderful. Is that what happens? No, it's not what happens. If anything, it puts a number on your back, right? You identify yourself with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Well, guess what? The God of this age, the God of this world, is going to come right at you now. Now I know who I need to go for. That's what I'm here to tell you. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil, to stand firm in the evil day. Battle is real. It can't be ignored. But so are the armor, the weapons that God has given us, so that you can stand when those things come your way. The full armor of God is what protects you when you have doubts, when you have fears, when you have guilt, when you have shame. The way you stand against the accusations of the enemy is to believe what God's word says about you instead. What he says about you. One of the greatest revivals in church history took place in Ephesus. The believers in Ephesus, the surrounding cities, faced great persecution for following after Christ. We saw that as we went through the seven churches of Revelation, right? Much, much persecution. But it was the raw power of the gospel, applying it to their lives through the armor of God that enabled them to stand firm, to overcome. They withstood persecution. They pushed back against false teachers. The amazing gospel of Jesus conquered the Roman Empire one heart, one home at a time. The whole armor is the expression of the full trust in God. Who he is, what he has done in the past, his promises for the future, what he's done for you through Jesus Christ. Sometimes we can look at the world around us and we can get discouraged. I mean, especially nowadays, turn on the news, read the paper, right? I mean, it's evil day, huh? Amen. May seem hopeless. But let me assure you, it is not hopeless. It's not hopeless. We are not the first generation to go through difficulties. So open your Bible. Read the countless stories of evil days. Countless stories of evil days. Then how God did amazing things in and through for his people in those evil days. We're going to end today with a video and a song that I think is very fitting for us. It's been on my mind for weeks and weeks. Very fitting. And I want to explain the words, the story behind the song. It's called Days of Elijah. Maybe some of you may have heard the song before. It's fairly new. I think it was written in 1994. I want to share with what the writer says about its meaning. Days of Elijah. It says we're living in times that require Christians to be filled with integrity. This was his motivation, how he felt the Spirit leading him as he wrote this song. He said we're living in times that require Christians to be filled with integrity. To stand up for him just like Elijah did. Just like Elijah did against the prophets of Baal. Elijah felt isolated in his culture, didn't he? But God told him to stand up, to speak for him. The reference to the days of your servant Moses. We also need to be holy and just people. Righteousness and right living are important in all our attitudes and our works. Days of great trial and famine, darkness and sword. It's a reflection of the times in which we live. And thousands of people die every day from starvation and malnutrition and war. In the midst of all of it, we're to call to make a declaration of what and who we believe in. He talks about Ezekiel's dry bones. This refers to the church rising up from the dead in unity of calling and purpose. Does it seem like the church has died? The church has lost its effectiveness? The church has lost its way? Ezekiel's dry bones, the church rising from the dead in unity and calling and purpose. The restoration of praise and worship to the church is represented by the days of your servant David. David had it on his heart to rebuild the temple for the Lord, to return praise and worship. Days of the harvest refers to the Christian calling of reaching the lost. The fields are as white in the world. It's from the King James. It means they're ripe for harvest. They're ripe for harvest. And then the chorus, the glorious chorus. Behold, he comes. It's the ultimate declaration of hope. Christ's return. He is coming back. Amen? Amen. He says, the year of Jubilee. What an apt description of what happens when someone comes to Christ. Prisoners are set free. Debts are canceled. That's what would happen during Jubilee. All prisoners would be set free. Every debt canceled. Everything would be reset. It's exactly what happens when we come to Christ. Prisoners are set free from the bondage of their sin. Debts paid. Christ pays debts. They're cleared. It's a song of hope for the church, the world in times of great trial. So we're going to sing the song. I'm going to tell you right now, and especially those that are watching online, the audio is not really great. It's not great quality video. It was shot a number of years ago, and kind of spur of the moment kind of thing. Kind of like the Holy Spirit moving. Although the quality of the audio is not great, the video might be a little grainy, I hope that you recognize the awesome thing that is happening. These soldiers, as they sing to their God. So join me as we sing.
Fields are as high as your word, and we are.
Amen. Those are soldiers who know who their God is. You think they have any fear as they go into battle? Hoorah! Every generation has had trouble. Every generation has had trials, had difficulties. The days of Elijah, he used that time of Elijah for a greater purpose, for David and for Moses. These are the days of who? Of you, of George. These are the days of George. These are the days of Larry. These are the days of Bob and Joanne. God is doing something amazing in your life. Maybe for the entire world, you have no idea how what he is doing in your life is going to affect all of eternity. Reflect on who he is. Put your trust in him. He has given you everything you need to stand in the day, in the evil day. Put on the whole armor of God. Know who he is, what he has done in the past, and what he has promised for the future. There is no God like Jehovah. Amen? There is no God like Jehovah. Hallelujah. Go in that confidence, as they did. I loved as they came to that part. There's no God like Jehovah. Did you notice what they did? They locked arms with one another. Right? That's what we need to do. That's why he brings us together. We need to lock arms. And we need to be excited, just as excited as they were. There's no God like Jehovah. There is no God like Jehovah. Why would we be silent? Why would we, let me tell you about Jesus. No, there is no God like Jehovah. Let me tell you what he has done in my life, what he can do in yours. Go in that excitement for who he is. Amen? Go. Go in the power of Christ. Amen.